I've known the Mindells for 25 plus years. They've been good friends. When they first came here, there was some talk of them building a center where they could house their retreats, their intensives, their workshops, just north end of town. There was a huge controversy about this. And as most controversies, it's ignorance. They've not done the research, they don't know the facts. I understood that they were working with professionals. These are all people in the mental health field. Psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers, people dealing with problems that people have in society. Other people thought it was a cult or something like that. Anyway, the center never came about, but the Mindells continue to run their workshops here in the Commons, over at the Lions Club, two or three times a year. I'll tell you a couple of interesting stories. Shortly after the city purchased this building, they had an offer from, what's the big dam? Bonneville Dam, to have a consultant come and investigate, look at all of our electrical needs in the whole building, heating, lighting, etc. City said, sure, there's no charge to the city. So they came. It also happened that the Mindells were having one of their seminars here at the same time. So we met with the consultant in room one. He said, oh yeah, well, we can replace all these lights. It was the old style light. They did it at their cost, not at the city's cost. So the city wasn't going to turn that down. So then he wanted to tour the whole building. So we came out in the hallway. The group had just broken into these small groups, three, four people. And they were spread out all over, up and down the hallway. They had dividers in here, and every little nook and cranny, there were three or four people sitting in it. Some were all back to back. Some were all head to head. Some shoulder to shoulder. And they were saying, ooh. The consultant looks at us, goes, what is going on here? So we try and explain to him what is going on. And I think he bought it. I'm not sure. But then we had to visit the boiler room down in the basement, see the old dragon down there. So we go down there, turn on the only single light bulb that's there. He bends over to look at the firebox. Just as he gets to the right angle, the boiler comes on, and this flame comes shooting out. It blows him back against the concrete wall. Doesn't get hurt, doesn't get burned, just shocked. And we were scared to death. We had never seen that. He says, you need to get that fixed. The city spent thousands and thousands of dollars on that old boiler. They replaced that boiler with a new boiler. They spent thousands and thousands on that boiler. Finally, last year, we replaced all these rooms that were dependent on the boiler system with the heat pump system. It's been a miracle. Another story was the Mindells used the Commons, they used the Lions Club. One year they decided to go to Walport, to Bayshore. So they set up this huge tent right by the Bayshore Inn. Well, it was in the middle of summer, our predominant northerly cold winds came through there, and just about put that tent in the middle of LC Bay. Their next sessions came back to Yachats. It is a personal pleasure of mine and an honor for the Academy to have Dr. Amy and Arnold Mindell do a presentation for us tonight. Please give them a warm Academy.
Thank you, Don. I'm really worried everybody will think we're a cult. thank you so much, Don, and the Academy, and for those hilarious stories, which I really don't remember, because it was a long time ago. And we want to thank you and everybody who is part of the Academy. Leon's here, and I just met our friends here, and everybody we know that it might not seem like a lot of work. Well, maybe it does. But it's a huge amount of work to put something like this together and all of the different presentations that happen. And none of us really know all those details in the background, so I really want to thank you and everybody, Milo, who's here, and everybody who's part of it. I'm obviously going to talk first, and then Artie's going to talk, and It's just, I noticed I'm a little bit, I'm either nervous or really excited. I'm quite amazed because we talk and we travel so much around the world and work with so many different people. And I think, but every time we talk, it always feels like it's a new group, a new atmosphere, a new place, except it's kind of an older place. I know it just feels like a delight to see you all, and it's amazing you came, partly because of the weather, it's so amazing. We were awed by that.
Are you nervous?
I think I'm it's great to be able to work with your partner.
Especially if you like each other.
Some of you know us, I think, and others of you we haven't met, obviously. I think those are the only two choices. We, for those who don't know us, we live part-time here in Yachats. We've been here, as Don was saying, a long time. I think we came in 1986 and have a home here. And just love the community, love the nature, and the people and everything. It's just our greatest joy is when we can come back here, and it's just so beautiful. And we also live part-time in Portland, where we have our private therapy practices and are part of a school of process-oriented psychology or process work. And some of our friends who either live here or are part of that community are here, and maybe they can, do you want to raise your hands as a case maybe later? Oh, no, you don't. Great. Maybe later we can point you out in case people would like to connect with you. And we also travel and teach process work around the world in a lot of places and do conflict resolution and what we call world work, which we'll be talking about tonight. I think it would be helpful for us to know how many of you are from Yachats? And how many of you are from other parts of the coast, upper, north, or south of the coast? And how many are from
elsewhere?
Anywhere else? Okay. Welcome to everybody.
Everybody comes from elsewhere.
Yeah. Everybody comes from elsewhere. Anybody feel like they come from the moon? because we work a lot with communities and groups, we thought it might be nice for the atmosphere if you wouldn't mind taking just 1 minute and turning and seeing if there's somebody right near you that you haven't met or you haven't seen in a long time. And just say your name and where you're from. And it just makes a nice atmosphere, and then maybe we can go on together. Just for 1 minute.
Solution, at least to half the world problems, what you just did. It's so simple. Some things are simple, some aren't. That's a simple thing. People you don't know and you're not too connected with, just making a little connection is the beginning of a big thing. We'll talk about the bigger thing later.
Okay. Tonight we'd like to particularly share with you about our large group conflict work and group facilitation. And we thought we'd talk about an hour or so and then see if you have questions after and we can talk together. And we'd like to bring a little bit of background and some theory, a little bit of theory to give a framework for what we do and a bunch of examples. I think some of my, this energy is that I feel very, I think I'm excited to share things with you because we've had a lot of very moving experiences with people around the world. And I know there's a lot of, we know obviously there's a ton of problems in the world and it can be very depressing. But we've had some experiences that make me hopeful about who we are as a human race and about our world and about our environment. And so it's a joy in a way to have the opportunity to share some of these things with you. And we also want to thank you for the work that you're doing in your life. Whether it's whether you work with groups or you work with organizations or you're working hard on your families or relationships. Sometimes we think families and relationships are like a lot tougher than other stuff in the world. Or you're just working on yourself and doing your own life. We think that whatever everyone does is really important. We need all of us to create a better world together. So I just want to thank you for whatever piece you're doing. So to understand our work with conflict, I think I'd love to give you just a brief overview of process work to give you a kind of context. And then I'll say a few things about our world work or conflict work, and then Arnie's going to go on. Okay. Some of you may know that Arnie developed process work in Switzerland in the 1970s. And then in the early 1980s, I went to Switzerland, and so did Julie. Where's Julie Diamond and Jan's work out there here? And a bunch of our friends, we went to Switzerland and lived there for a long time. And I helped to develop process work, particularly in the areas of creativity. I love writing music and making crazy puppets and doing all sorts of strange things. And also movement work and working with people in coma or near death. That's another aspect of our work. And a basic principle behind process work has to do with following process or following nature. That is, how does nature express herself or itself through us in ourselves as individuals, in relationships, or in our groups? What do we experience? And with the idea that if we can follow and unfold those experiences that are happening naturally inside of us or in our groups, even the toughest places, like working with body symptoms, working with large groups in conflict, or working with somebody who's near death, that those experiences are really, can be really tough. But if we really follow them, we can find that they contain a lot of wisdom and meaning right within the experiences themselves. It's kind of a basic principle in the background that already began to develop, and then some of us are developing together. For example, just a really simple example of that is, if you think of a woman that we worked with recently who had, I'll just say it really briefly, who had a bad back. She had a very bad back pain. And she did everything she could for it medically. And then she wanted to find out more about it, what it might be expressing to her. So we asked her, well, what is your experience of that back pain like? And she said, well, it's kind of like this, very tight fist she made. And we said, well, what is that like for you? And she said, wow, well, that feels like kind of powerful for her. It was like something like that. And that was a lot of strength. She said, oh, that's a kind of strength and a kind of pride in who I am. This was a very shy woman, and it was very hard for her to have access to her own strength and her own power. It was something she didn't identify with easily. But that was sort of expressing itself through this miserable back pain. And she, by the way, she dreamed at night of very powerful leaders in the world. So this was the idea, if you can follow that, that Arnie discovered of the dream body, which is that the kinds of things we're experiencing in our body, the body symptoms and experiences, if we unfold them and follow them, those experiences, like her strength, mirrored her dream of these very powerful figures. That's the mirror connection between body experiences and dreams.
You said it, I mean. Our body symptoms are symptoms but there also are dreams trying to be realized. If you can pick some of that up, your body is sometimes relieved, at least temporarily, yeah.
So, well, we won't go into that whole part this evening, but I wanted to show you a kind of picture that I made. It got a little crumpled up from all my luggage around the world, but since this time of these ideas of trying to follow nature and what is nature expressing, I made this sort of flower. You can see it. I don't know how well you can see it, but at the bottom of it is the idea of following nature or process, like coming from the ground. And then up from that is, like, I like to show the different applications that have sprouted up from process work from this early time. There's many more, but these are a few of them. I kind of see them as petals on a flower. One of them is working with movements or movement difficulties. World work is here. You probably can't see that so well, but world work or our conflict work. There's inner work, part of our work, relationship work, dream and body work, working with people in coma and near death. Working with people in extreme and altered states of consciousness, or what's known normally thought of as psychotic states or psychiatry. And there's many, many other petals, but they're all connected to this idea of following nature. Just gives you a little overview. Okay. Now with that overview, maybe we can turn to our world work and conflict resolution work. Is that okay with you? Are you with me, more or less?
Woof.
He woofs a lot. You know, if you've been around town, you may have gotten woofed by me. Woofed by people with woofs. Just to give you an idea of some of the places that we've worked, and I know some of our friends who are here have worked in many different places around the world. We've worked, Arnie and I, together in South Africa before the revolution with different conflicting parties. We worked in Ireland with so-called terrorists. I say so-called because that's not the name that they had for themselves. They call themselves freedom fighters. We worked in Oakland during the Rodney King trials, if some of you remember, in the 1990s. It was a very, very intense, difficult time. I think you're going to give an example of that, certainly, on race relations. We've worked in Aboriginal communities in various parts of the world. The one I think of now is we worked with the Haida Nation. Some of you know, on the Queen Charlotte Islands, just my sense of direction is terrible, but
North,
off the coast of Canada. North is up there. We work with them and help them to gain their land rights back with their interaction with the Canadian government. And we're so happy to hear about a year ago or so, they did get those land rights back. So that was really very powerful for us. And also my mind is in May. Was it May? A few months ago, we were just in Yokohama, Japan, where we were working at the United Nations University on conflicts around nuclear energy and from the whole fallout of the tsunami and the earthquake. It just makes me cry to even think of. And we'll talk about that, maybe show you an example of what happened there. It was very moving between the government and the protesters, and I'll save that for later. So I'd like to say a little bit about, just to give a framework, about some basic ideas of our conflict work and world work. Basically, we think until now, just generally, that the world has some good methods for dealing with problems, but it hasn't been very gifted, let's say, in dealing with really difficult conflict situations, really entrenched conflict in the world, and especially creating better and sustainable relationships between different parties. And we think we need to represent all people and nature in all community discussions and all forums to help create a more sustainable world and develop better relationships between the different sides. Not just making solutions, but better relationships as a whole. I think you're going to talk about that more. And we also think we need what Arnie has called deep democracy. Some of you may have heard of that, which is really a deeper democracy than we have now, which makes it possible, I feel, to bring some of the ideals, the basic fundamental ideals of democracy to life in our groups, in our relationships, and in our moment-to-moment interactions, so we can really realize some of those basic principles more fully. And maybe I can show you that here, if you can see it. I made a little chart here. I put some key words here that I'll talk about, and after that, Arnie's going to go further. Can you see that back there? Mm-hmm. Sort of? I'll be saying it anyways. You can come up later. Deep democracy basically means, and Arnie, you're going to talk about it more, valuing all the people in a given system or organization or group, all of the different parts, and all the different levels of experience. And when we say levels of experience, it means that there are lots of different aspects of our experiences that are happening at the same time while we're interacting in groups, but we usually don't notice all of them. But to have really sustainable change, we think we need to touch on all of these different levels. So I'd like to share them with you a little bit and give you an idea about those levels. There are three of them. One of them is what we call consensus reality, or the reality that a particular group consents on as being real. Not necessarily the reality, but a group's reality. And that level is usually the level that most groups focus on first. It's primary on their minds. It's the thing that they really need to focus on first, usually. And that consensus reality includes things like facts and issues of the particular problems that the group wants to work on, the different stakeholders who are on one side of the issue or another, the history of the given issues or organization, diversity issues between people, rank and power differences, who has more power, who has less power, and all of that, finances, and many other things. And when there's conflict, usually the different sides, everything feels very static and kind of immobile and really difficult to work with because it's so static and so entrenched. And this level of consensus reality is really where laws and structures are made and all those things that, like that, very important. However, if we only focus on that level, which is obviously really important, we can miss other things in the background that, if missed, makes it very hard to have sustainable resolutions. So let me name these two other levels for you. And we're going to be giving a lot of examples of this stuff. The second level we call dreamland. Now, for some people that may sound a little weird, and for other people that may sound wonderful, depending on who you are. But dreamland is really actually extremely practical. It simply means all of the background feelings and experiences and dreams and
projections.
Thank you. And body signals that we make that we're not noticing in consensus reality, that are kind of marginalized into the background. But they're so important to notice if you're working with conflict or you're working with groups. For example, maybe we can show a little example. Think of a business negotiation or some kind of political negotiation or something like that, okay? Let's say that Arnie and I are about to... Is your mic working?
Yeah.
Okay.
We've got to sign an agreement.
Yeah, let's say we're going to make an agreement. We say, okay, we're going to agree to whatever. And we come together.
And we're from any culture. What we're going to do is cross-cultural. We've seen it everywhere.
Mm-hmm. And we come together and we're... Just watch what we do.
Watch the same thing.
It's a little hard to do with a microphone.
The reality is we're going to sign a contract, that's consensus reality. In the dream area, dreamland area, we call that, we are, body signals and things of that sort are not conscious. They're unconscious. So keep your eye on my body signals and yours. Okay, Madam So-and-so?
Okay, Mr. So-and-so?
Yes.
Okay.
What do you want?
Let's agree. Let's agree about this.
Okay. I agree entirely.
Okay. You're laughing, which is really great, because we call this a double signal. We're saying, yes, we agree, and he's looking out to you, looking at us.
So I do agree.
I like that you're laughing, because comedians, this is the stuff comedians are made of frequently. They show double, what we call double signals, two signals, brilliantly. That's why they're so funny. So, okay, here we come. Now we're going to make the agreement.
Yes, we are.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's shake.
What do you read in my voice, in my face?
Not so much.
I'm
trying to get it over with.
Yeah. Yeah. Make war against her. I want to make war against her. I want to do the opposite of what I'm saying here. And we can just show that at the Institute for Advanced Studies there at the United Nations University, the leader of the UN group came forward and he said, "That's the problem with the UN. Can you see it? They go for the agreement and not the process in the background. That's why agreements don't hold. You've got to work the stuff out. You can't just shake hands and sign something." Anyway, I'll talk
more. It's a huge thing, so if you don't notice that, you'll be as surprised, amazed, and whatever. Later, when one of us or both of us drop out of the negotiation, you can't figure out why, because we all said yes. Sure. You know, it happens all the time. Double signals are natural. It's not that you shouldn't have them.
Yeah.
But that we need to notice them and follow them at all these different levels to really have something sustainable at the end.
Don't go just for the solution. Watch the overall process.
Another aspect of this whole dreamland level is the idea that in consensus reality, there are people on one side of an issue and then people on another side. But from the dreamland perspective, from another perspective, if we change it a little bit, we can think of a group as something, like having something like a background field, and all of these different sides, which seem to belong very strongly to one person or group or another, are really more like roles that everybody shares to some degree. That we all have the different parts in us, the different roles and sides, to some degree, even if it's very little. But we know these energies are things inside of ourselves somehow, even those sides and people that we hate the most or dislike the most. To some little degree, that we share that field, that we share all of those different roles. I want to say something, I can feel it.
What? The bad guy is in me too? Yes.
To some degree. And if you know that energy, also in the other, you can work with it. Somebody's nodding, I'm happy. You can work with it better. You know it inside of yourself, especially as a facilitator, I think you'll talk about. So if all of the different roles are shared, something that we ask people sometimes is to use their awareness and notice when I'm in this position and standing for that strongly, and when I suddenly, something changes and I could actually go to another position and represent it, because I know it in myself too. And when that happens in this group process, things begin to move, things begin to flow, and there's more fluidity in the field. And because of that, more possibility happens. And there's just one more thing I want to mention about dreamland, and then I'll say a couple sentences about the last level, and then Arnie will go on. The last thing I want to mention in dreamland is what we call ghost roles, which also may sound a little strange, but it's actually, I think, one of the most important aspects of group process that I can think of. I think Arnie will give some examples, and I will too, just now. Ghost rules means, a ghost rule means, well, everybody knows it. Has anybody here ever gossiped to anybody? Hey, there you go! Oh, one of the younger members has. Yeah. You know how when you gossip and you think about, like, you talk about other people who aren't there and stuff? Or you can talk about, a group can be together and talk about the trees that are dying, or they can, you can talk about President Obama or somebody, or George Bush or something. A ghost role means anybody that's talked about but is not directly there and not directly represented within the group. And when we notice ghost roles, we try to bring them in and represent that position right there, because that energy or that opinion is needed as part of our group process. And I'll give you two examples of that. Can you follow that? For example, a simple example is, I'm thinking of a social service organization that we worked with some years ago, and the employees were exhausted, they were overworked, and they were got together, and we were having a little process, and they mentioned all their needy clients that they felt they couldn't give enough to these people who really needed their help. They wanted to so bad, but they were really upset because they couldn't do it. And we noticed that those needy clients were like the ghost role of that group. So at one point, one of us suggested, well, can someone speak for that needy client, or is somebody feeling like a needy client here? And then everybody started speaking because they were so miserable and overworked, like many people working in social service organizations or volunteer groups or whatever, that they didn't have a chance to talk about their own needs and their own difficulties, their difficulties at home, their exhaustion with their work, etc. And once they did that, they became much more free, they had more energy, there was a great relief, and they felt they could kind of renew themselves and were able to do more. That's one example, and I'll give you one other example that really moved me very deeply. It's from Athens.
Oh, from Greece, yes.
Yeah, it was very emotional for me. I tried to explain it to you very briefly of a ghost role, working with that. We were in Athens, Greece, about a year and a half ago, I think. And right in the midst of their economic turmoil, and it was really difficult. They were very depressed and angry. A lot of people were really angry. There was a lot of depression. There was 40% more suicide than was up 40% than it had been. Tons of people losing their jobs and all of that. It was really, really difficult. And at one point, there was a small group. There were different small groups meeting. And there was one group of social activists who had gotten together to work on their stuff. And they were really angry at their own government and people. They were really angry at the European Union, at what was happening. And they were fighting really hard, and had been fighting really hard for what they wanted. And while that was happening, they got a phone call, a cell phone, and found out that one of their colleagues, who was not at the seminar, obviously, had lost his job and had taken his life. And it was devastating to them. And it was so incredibly painful. And I remember we sat down and we started talking about what happened. To make a long story short, I remember at one point, Arnie, you said to them, what sounds like that man who took his life is like a ghost role, somebody we're talking about. Could anybody represent him? And these people were amazing. They were, not every group can do that, but one man who was really the strongest social activist said, well, I want to try that. And what he did was, he laid on the ground as if he was dying.
Yeah.
that. He made like Arnie showing like this. And he was quiet for a little bit, and then he said, "Oh, I feel so free and detached. I haven't felt this for years. I'm so caught up in the everyday struggle." And he was so happy laying there, really. And then he put out his hands like that, and his whole group came around him and grabbed his hands. And he said, and they all said really, "Oh, this is..." They loved each other, and this is our sense of community. And this is what we as Greeks really have. This is our gift. And no matter what's taken away from us or how much is taken away from us, we're going to have this, and we're going to survive, because that's really our beauty. And that's what we can rely on. You can take everything away. And it was incredibly touching. And it turned out then later, when we came back to the large group, there were some people who had come from different parts of the European Union that these activists were really angry at. And this man, I remember, fought hard with somebody from another country, and then he was able to go and really understand her in this most unbelievable way. Partly because he had been able to go through that experience, I think, himself. I don't know what he did exactly, but it was incredibly moving. Yeah. So, did you want to add something?
He was still an activist, but he was more. He was a solution bringer, too. You know?
So that was just very moving to me. It's kind of hard to talk about emotional things in theory at the same time. I do want to say that mentioned this last level of the essence, because he helped to get there. The essence level in deep democracy really means like a common ground, that there's a shared, getting in touch with that background shared field of a group where you have a sense of unity or common ground, at least for a moment. It doesn't mean you have to stay there. That can be unnatural if there's a lot more conflict that needs to happen. But noting it can be very important. And he, by getting so deep in himself, he was able to get to that deep level. And for facilitators at this essence level, if you're interested in facilitating, it's really helpful and important to get to this deep essence level, connecting with the deepest part of you, and what Arnie calls the process mind, which he'll talk about. It's a kind of sense of being an elder who's really there for everybody, for the different sides, and is able to help the flow of what happens and to discover new types of resolutions in the field. Yeah. I think that's all I want to say, maybe. Do you want to go?
Thank you, Amy. Yeah. Wow. We've had a lot of experiences, and it's in a way, it's a relief to talk about some of them. We live in an amazing world, really. It's an awfully wonderful and beautiful place, but it's got a lot of problems. And I think some of them could be solved if we changed some elemental ways and learn in kindergarten. What I'm going to talk about tonight are things that you can learn in kindergarten. Had we learned some of these things in kindergarten, it sure wouldn't have hurt. Maybe even more fun. Yeah. So right now, as I said before, we're at the United Nations group there at the Institute of Advanced Studies. We are being tested against other conflict resolution procedures. And what we're doing, useful, does it work, does it not work? After we finished, they stopped the testing, and the other group that was going to be tested simply said, that's okay what they're doing, you know, you do go further. Very nice, and it was a good experience. But the question is this, the thing that we're grappling with all the time is this. You know, each of us know you have your own methods for solving and resolving conflicts. And they may not all be conscious, but you have them. Talk to the other person, listen to the other person. Are they right? Bring up your side. Some of us need more courage to bring their points up. Others need more courage to listen to the other side. We're all a little bit different than it. And there's lots of really good mainstream methods for dealing with conflict. Listen to the other side. What do you need to get to the table? Do you need to get to the table? These are very powerful consensus building techniques. Excellent. But as far as we know right now on this planet that we're living on, there's almost nothing that deals with people who are furious and don't want to go to the table and talk. It's an area that we know so little about. We all need to wake up about that. We need to study it more. We need to understand it more. So we're suggesting some things here. It's very touching to me, very important that we learn how to get along with people who are so disturbed and so upset they could kill somebody else without thinking they're just bad people. They're human beings who are over the edge. They're just hurt and pressured, and it's just not all good and evil. It's a little too easy. So we need something to work with that instead of simply saying it's not good. Yes, I agree. A lot of people that we work with, I really don't like them that much. And they do. I understand where they're coming from. If you've ever been in a bad fight, I hope you haven't, but just in case you have, you'll understand these people better. So, is there something? And yes, this is the reason that we're amplifying the idea of democracy with a little deeper democracy, as Amy's been explaining, by going a little bit deeper. And I think maybe examples show this. I think of Oakland right now. That's a city, some of you may know that, in California. It's a largely African-American city. And at the time, in the 90s, some of you may remember the Rodney King trial. Their light-colored or white policemen did bad stuff to Rodney King, an African-American. And this was just before the trial, right?
Just before the verdict came out.
Just before the verdict was going to come out on those policemen. It was quite amazing. So you have to imagine, there we are in Oakland. There's 200...
300 and lots of police.
The room twice as big, just filled with people, police on all the different sides. And then on the one side, this is... I remember working with conflict, and don't forget the essence level. I'm going to give just an example about how someone getting to the essence level was very helpful. So, on the one side, people were saying, you white people, you just never get it. You just can't understand. And a lot of some of the white-colored people, I better say, on the other side, they're saying, we're trying, we want to. Oh, you're trying, you want to. That sounds like junk. Yeah. And he's on that side. And we hear they're saying, we try to do our best, you know. And anyway, to make the story short, the sounds are going up on both sides, and one single man in the middle of this group, one single person, was really deep in himself. And at first he sounded a little weird, but then something amazing happened. On this side they said, you guys are no good. And we try to be good, you're not getting it. And that going up in him, he started, we made sounds like that. And then he went on the other side and said, for the white people, and he started talking. Black pain. And then he put it on the other side, and he said, "White pain." And the people first looked at him, "What's he doing?" And he went on the side and said, "Black pain, oh, and he started to make sounds like that. And he said, "Oh, white pain." There's so much. It was, you see, he got to the essence of what the people were trying to express. And because of that, as he did that, suddenly on one side of the room, people began to speak and sing. Whoa! And so the African American communities, one of them began to sing a song. Of all the things on the other side of the room, some Irish people began to sing an Irish song. And on this side, I think it was a German song came out. And then another African-American song went. You won't believe it. People were singing songs and listened to one another. And afterwards, we stopped and to consider now what's the next. I think there was a coming together, momentary. Next day, when the Rodney King trial came, and
The verdict came out.
In favor of the police, there was riots all around the United States, except in Oakland. And the San Francisco Chronicle gave us credit for what had happened, though it was this one man that did that. I want to say, just one person getting to the essence of different sides can change the world. We need that person. He should be the leader. He's the leader.
Arnie, could you try using that other mic?
Use the other mic. Yeah.
Sure. Is
that better? Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Is it me or was it the mic?
A little both.
A little both. I like that. Yeah.
That's a good resolution.
Mm-hmm.
That's a
bit. So, yeah. So the ethics that we have. So the idea is that democracy is really, really good. It's great. It's worth fighting for. But what does democracy mean? Demo? Krati. What's the word demo mean in Greek? As if you would know. Citizens. And krati? Power. What did someone say?
Rule.
And power. Thank you. Power. So, demo, citizen. Democracy, citizen power. We know how important that is, that people have power, equal power, and it's worth fighting for and dying for. But hey, power is not going to resolve relationship issues. Being strong and being powerful is terribly important. We need more people like that. And at the same time, it isn't the more subtle methods that are needed for solving relationship problems. So that's why we need some of us, and some people can just automatically go down to their deepest side, like that I need to work on myself to get there. This man didn't. Some of you maybe can do that sometimes. Right? I can sometimes, but not all the time. So this is part of the idea of deep democracy. We need to feel and get to the feeling and the dreaming level in the background. There's an ethic in here, and the ethic is that everybody, now this is not something you should really push, but if you're a facilitator, it helps a lot if you think everybody is your family. That's a big statement to say, especially in a really rough neighborhood and with difficulties going on. But everybody, even people you don't like very much, well, maybe they're a little bit part of your family. Eek. Listen, we live on one planet. It looks at us as part of its family. The universe sees us as part of its family. Some of us could try that and all of that. Do you think the other person somehow, as somebody's got to learn to get along? Because family doesn't mean good, because somebody's part of your family. You know, the worst conflicts we've ever seen actually are in small families.
Anybody ever discovered that? You don't have to raise your hand. So, can you empathize occasionally? Can you feel into the other person's side a little bit occasionally? That's what we'd like people to learn how to do. Once in a while, not even all the time, once in a while would change the world. Feeling into somebody, just think of somebody you don't like very much, that so-and-so. Just think, you can feel into the other side on rare occasions what that person is feeling and stand for what they feel. The world would be easier, it would be a better place. So, as Amy was implying, all of our work has come from working with terrorists and government people and conflicts everywhere where dialogue is good, but it's not enough. We need to work on signals and signal consciousness. I want to give you an example about that, that you can talk about these things because I've written about them in my book, but I always want to mention one. Signal consciousness. So imagine Ireland. Are you with me so far? If I am, could you say woof? Thank you, that helps. Yeah. You don't know, sometimes when you're talking, you don't know where the audience always is. That's good. Now I'm here too, actually. I was most so much in these things, these scenes, that. Imagine Ireland just before the peace accord in Ireland. And here's another example, but here's another. So one of the things we've been talking about is bringing in the roles, ghost roles that aren't mentioned. Here's how the signal, double signal has happened. On the one side, there were, again, hundreds of people in a room. And on the one side, one of the main politicians in Ireland at the time, I won't even say which side they were on. I'm going to make another kind of point. One was saying, you guys are terrible. I was just coming out of my house, going into the garden to see my family. And you guys came in and you shot us. I'm the only living member of my family. I hate you. And the group was yelling and screaming. Everybody who loves Irish should be pretty expressive. On the other side, the room, the politician was saying, you say that. How can you say that? We were sitting at a bar on such and such a street. You came in and you shot my friends right in front of me. And the group begins roaring with anger. The two sides are screaming and yelling at each other. And I was out of it. We were out of it. But I remember, what did I learn? Didn't I learn something once? Signals? You can't think sometimes. The situation is so heavy. You just can't think. But I did remember this one thing. Signals. So the one man, I looked into the middle of the room, and there was that one politician, just this right cheek over here was so red. It was redder than red. It was very red. And I said to him, with the microphone, because from the loud crowd, your cheek is very red. Why is that? And he stopped. Well, of course it's red, he said. Why? I said. He said, my doctor told me not to come tonight to this meeting. Why? He said. He said, you have lethally high blood pressure. If you continue to go on like you are, you could die. Everybody got quiet. The other man, that means the politician from the other side, said, you could die. My doctor told me. I had a heart attack 3 weeks ago. I shouldn't even be here. What am I doing here? Everybody, the whole group is quiet. And then the amazing moment happens when the first politician put his arms slowly out and walked slowly to the other side, where his opponent was standing. Yes, and the bell rang. Just then. Big moments. That was big. That's wonderful. Thank you. Is that somebody's fault?
You rang a lot of bells.
Your bell rang at the right moment just now. Because he went to the other side slowly with his arm, and of all the unbelievable things, he gently, and it took him a couple of minutes to do this, put it around his opponent. We could both die. And it was an amazing moment. People were very quiet, everyone was silent, and came together. And then decided we'll go further and discuss what can be done next in the world together. That was just a couple of days before the peace accord was signed. That was Dublin some years ago. So again, the signal, you're working with a conflict, you're looking at a conflict in your family or in yourself, watch the signals. They can lead to resolutions. Because anyone's double signal, like I was making before, the face color, or this or that or whatever, your signals are linked to the relationship situation that isn't being made conscious. So by bringing up the one man's problem, the other one suddenly found a unifying factor in it. It's another aspect of that. So, Ireland. Mm-hmm. And the idea is that by working this way, going deeper makes more relationship. It's not just resolution that counts, it's relationship. Okay, I'll be brief. Huh? Okay, we started a little bit late. I'll be another 10 minutes. Is that okay?
Yes.
Are you with me?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. That's very helpful. So. That must be a ghost roll. Did you get it turned off? Yeah, that's wonderful. Oh, yeah, listen. Yeah, I love that. That's our connection with the world. That's we're talking about the world. So, political sustainability. So it takes practice. I just want to say that. It takes a lot of practice as this Ireland thing and the Oakland thing says, shows very clearly. On the other hand, I want to say something about conflict itself, because whenever conflict comes up, people always say, oh no, not again, not that country, not more conflict from that country. But I want to say, in many, many ways, conflict is natural. It belongs to everyday life. We just don't like it very much, but it belongs to everybody. It's a natural phenomenon. We need to take a stand and protect ourselves, also as governments, and we need armies and everything, but that's not the whole story. And this reminds me of Zurich. Now, Zurich, Switzerland, how many, well, you know, some of you live in Switzerland or have lived in. Personally, you know Swiss, you're Swiss. You know that the Swiss don't talk very much to one another in public. Not too much. Is that right?
Well,
not much.
Not
too much. So for the Swiss to have a conflict, an open conflict is a rather unusual thing. Is that right? That's very unusual. So the city of Zurich had a conflict a couple of years ago and asked us to help. Conflict in Zurich? Yes.
In public.
In public. The city sponsored an open forum. We had with 800 people. So, and one of the, after the forum, by the way, one of the Swiss women came up to me and she said, you said we should talk to one another? I did say that, yes. I love those people. In any case, the city of Zurich had decided that in the city, you might as well, anyone who has got the money should pay for the property they want. So the richest people came in and they bought this property and they bought that property, and the wealthy people bought also all the poor properties that were, or the in the bad section, so-called poorer sections of town. So the fine reserve became a place where nobody could live but the richest.
In the center.
People had to move out of town. Everybody was moving out of town. So we had an open forum about that. But I want to say, it's a natural thing. The forum was very good. It came out well. There was understanding. At the end, one of the activists said, "What good is it?" Thank you. It's still there. One of the activists there said, "What good is all this talk have to do? We just talked about all the government and everything. We heard from various sides. What good does all this have to do?" And a very brave and very well-known politician, leading political figure from another city, came forward and said, "I was hiding in the back, but I heard everything. And I will change." The idea in the background is that it's normal to have conflict. Government always makes decisions, rarely enough connection with the people, but still it's important to make a decision. You don't want to have to be involved in every decision the government makes. But so conflict arises automatic. The people have to come forward and say, "Woof," and then there's woof, and there's the government, and there's a little trouble. But it's also a good thing, because the whole city wakes up to its nature. It's not just a bad thing. Now, personally, the conflicts I have, I hate until Amy reminds me. You said they're sometimes good. I suppose it's natural to say conflict. I don't like it, but remember, it can also be good. And the last thing I want to say is I want to stress the ghost role, and how important it is in group process, especially to be able to be fluid yourself. And I want to just show something for a moment. Amy, can you act this out for me? Because it's easier to see than it is just to say. Can you be this, imagine we're now in Japan, and we're about ready to work there with the UN group, and over here is standing somebody looking suspiciously at them. And I'm coming in the room, and we're going to, Amy and I are coming in the room, and over here is somebody looking very weirdly at me like that. Remember, I'm an American, we're in Japan.
I'm Japanese.
You're Japanese.
I'm Japanese.
Amy's Japanese. And you come in the room like this, and I take a look at that person. Okay, what did I say? You should be empathizing into the other, so much so that sometimes they don't even have to talk. So I look at that person, and I sort of looked at me like that too, in my own mind, and went closer to the person a little bit. That's what I'm safe. I looked at myself. Suddenly I realized I could empathize into what he was thinking. What is this American doing here in Japan, trying to help us with troubles among us?
Exactly.
That's what he said. I spoke for him, and then he didn't say exactly. He just smiled. And I just say, read a little bit into parties which look not entirely in agreement with you. That's important. Just feeling your way into the other side is something I can't stress enough. And in a group process, create open forums in your city, in your family, wherever you are, and in these open forums, bring forth one basic polarity, at least one basic polarity, and then work with the details of it. And the polarity I want to show you now this evening is this polarity around nuclear energy. Okay? So Amy and I are going to act this out. Now we're in Japan, we're at the UN, and are you going to be, shall I be the government?
Sure.
Or do you want to be the protester?
Okay.
Okay. I'm the government, and we're talking about nuclear energy. This is a very big thing for our whole world.
I don't know if you've heard, but there's protests happening. It's very unusual for plan now around nuclear energy?
Has been and are. And what Japan decides finally about nuclear energy will influence the whole, is influencing the world. So, what do you want to talk about?
We don't say this normally in public, it's hard, but we are so angry. Do you know what just happened to so many people? We cannot have nuclear energy in this country.
Angry?
Yes.
Please watch how you talk to me.
I can't go by that anymore. We can't afford it.
We have to speak. We need nuclear energy for economics. It's easier on economics. We have to go back to it.
Remember the tsunami. Remember what happened. We can't have it.
Okay. Then I encourage people to switch roles. And a few could, not everybody. A few could. We are just totally pissed off with you.
We can't survive in this little island if we don't create our own power.
We want to now speak out.
Don't speak like that to me.
Okay. We're at an impasse for the moment. Let me think. We are talking about Fukushima. We're talking about where the problem was. We're talking about a ghost role. Is there somebody here that could represent that? Suddenly.
About five.
Five people rushed forward, crying and sobbing and saying, protesters, you don't understand us. You're not talking about us. Government, what are you talking about? You have no relationship. We saw our family drown and die and burn.
You've forgotten us. You conflict, but you've forgotten us. They were all from the Fukushima area. We didn't know.
We lived in it. You're talking about it. That makes a difference. They sob. And Japanese is unusual.
They don't usually show those emotions.
It's a very strong experience, yes. And they came, the people stopped. They sat down together. And some cried and people were quiet. And then we began the process of what can we do to work together. So I just want to bring in again the idea of the role, the ghost role, mentioned but not brought in. So
we also didn't say that then from that forum, the UN University decided to sponsor a year of open forums in the Fukushima area with some of these people and others who are going to go around and try to bring also a lot of relief, because the people don't have that access to talk to people and to process their experiences and find out how they can make an impact on what happens.
Yes. I was told there are 8 different forums that are going on based upon this particular method in the Fukushima area. Yeah. So the last thing I want to say is, and then we'll open up for questions. The last thing I want to talk about, it's on the floor. This is a very brief outline about how to do a forum. Obviously, the first step is to have speakers, after having chosen a particular polarity, have speakers from various sides speak one at a time. Then, encourage them to dialogue. Then the third thing, after the dialogue, is encourage people to switch roles. Now, not many can, sometimes no one can, but the facilitator can try to do that. Go back and forth between the roles, like Amy and I were saying, that can be very helpful sometimes. If possible, during an open forum, even if it's with your family, and please do an open forum with your family if there's a conflict. That's the place it should be done first. That's why I said kindergarten. After people have been talking together, what have you. Everybody should be quiet just for a few minutes and gossip one-to-one about what's happening in the forum to bring the quiet people in so that not just the louder people speak of forums. That's an important point. Don't forget ghost roles. Remember, we've given you some examples of that. And slow down if there's a resolution and just hold it there. Finally, of course, all forums should have time to discuss what can be done next. Well, I think that's just about what I wanted to say. The last statement I say is for the UN to work best as its founders dreamed, for there to be more respect for human rights. Someone, a facilitator, you or me, someone has to sit in the fire a little bit sometimes and try to appreciate the various sides without telling everybody they have to be nice. That's all I have to say. It's good. Represented here in the United States, and I can talk to someone playing you, or if you're smart, you'll send somebody over so you can actually take the roles of and show these things around the world. It's not enough just to make conflict. We want more relationship. Thank you for that.
And that also means you really.
That's a tough answer.
What's that?
Yes. Sorry? That was a pretty tough answer. I think you kind of did.
Do you think I did? Thank you. Yeah, that's a very hard thing.
It's really hard.
We
have a government building.
I was just saying, it's the question. I'm so glad you asked it, because it's the nastiest and worst spot that we have everywhere in the world.
Someone says,
sometimes we have to really just take a stand. That's also part of it, and just say no.
Stop it.
And then there's, then what? Then what can we do? What else? Because we don't want to only repeat history and revenge, and you know, what everybody knows what history's like. So
in South Africa, just before the, we were doing, this is a great question. Someone in South Africa, we worked in South Africa, the two tribes were arguing with one another, and somebody from one of the tribes said to somebody from the other tribe, if we don't solve this here, when we go outside, I have a weapon in my pocket, I'm going to kill you. And one of the lighter colored people came to him, oh, sweetie, you don't want to do that. And the person said, and then we said, if you've been down, if you've been disrespected, if you've been abused and hurt so long, murder is almost a sense of relief. Don't do it. Sense at least the pain of the other person. That works. So that was a really good question. Thank you. How to feel it to people the size that are really very, maybe very different than you. Yeah, Brian?
Middle is disappearing, and people can't get elected if they talk to the other side.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely.
How can you, you have to trick them?
There's
no compromise going on?
That's so exciting. Yeah. Our elections are based upon democracy. We vote for the people who are strongest and most powerful, not always the ones who are most able in relationship. Mm-hmm. And I understand that. I also think there's all sorts of things there. The solution to our world problems starts in kindergarten. Teach ourselves early on.
If we could find people who are in those positions, great, all the better. Like Arnie's saying, we need it in kindergarten, and as you know, right, we need all of us or anybody who feels able, even if it's in your littlest spot in your life, to try to facilitate, try whatever other methods that you have also. We need all of us, not only to look at the big leaders as the ones who have to do everything or should do everything.
Yeah, the solution to world problems starts in kindergarten. Yeah. Maybe
we should just take
one more question, and then we'll get a couple of time.
Governments have body language too. They send signals.
What's that? Governments?
Governments have body language too. They send signals. They don't always sit down and talk. They just send a signal.
That's right.
Absolutely. We do all the time, but it's not part of most leaders' education. Doesn't have to do with noticing body signals and what they're saying. I think all leaders should have to have some training in psychology and facilitation and all those things.
Well,
it couldn't hurt.
People go for become president without any
prerequisites.
What do you want? You know? Yeah. It's our planet. One more question, then we'll close up the room. Yeah.
Hi. Well, thank you for letting me ask.
Is that a hard signal?
Sure. Not a signal. No, I was just wondering how do you work through when one party is willing to be empathetic to the other, but the other party isn't willing to see their side? It's off balance. You know what I mean? Like someone can give that empathy, but there's no one on this other side to do that. What do you do to keep it moving?
Well.
Oh. No, you already started talking. No, you came out of your mouth already.
No, yeah, I did shut my mouth, that's true. I worked in it again. Yeah. Empathizing into the other side is one step. But then empathizing into your own and standing strongly for that also is extremely important. All the sides need complete expression. Woof, I can't stand your rotten guts because of A, B, and C. And, well, one of the reasons you don't understand me and don't like me because you don't know where I'm coming from in the first place. Let's keep going back and forth and the understanding will happen.
So you do just keep it, trust the process, and you just keep it coming out, like, let it all float up and it'll somehow magically always resolve?
Trust the process. Does it always magically resolve?
yo. That means yes and no. The resolution isn't the point, I'm going to say. It is the point, but it's not the big point. The big point is the sustainable contact with the other person. You know, a resolution is great. We all need them and want them. But can you get along with that monster on the other side a little bit better? Because if you can, you've changed the universe.
One person can go back and forth, that can make a huge thing. Even if the others will never, will change.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. At home, even for people who've been divorced.
I think we better close up.
Close up for the
Thank you, everybody.